One of my viewers asked me for a fish stock video, and I thought, why don't we kill two birds with one stone? Learn to make a fish stock and turn it into the most aromatic, hearty, and satisfying Provencal fish soup. I call it bouillabaisse, you can call it whatever you want. In case you need a good reason to make the soup right now, let me give you one. It's orange. It's gory, and it's a way more original addition to your Halloween feast than, say, a pumpkin muffin. The first thing you'll need to do is go fish shopping. I suggest you call your fishmonger a few days ahead, just to make sure they have what you want. Here are the instructions to give them. You'll need two whole branzini, scaled, gutted, gills removed, filleted, and skinned. Ask for all the skinless fillets in one bag and all the heads, bones, and skin in another. Traditional bouillabaisse was a way for fishermen in Marseille to get rid of all sorts of fish that they couldn't sell by the end of the day. So obviously that soup usually included way more than one variety of fish. But you are not a fisherman in Marseille in the 1800s. Chances are, you might actually have to pay for your fish. So if you're paying, you might just as well choose whatever tastes best. Salmon, bluefish, mackerel, or trout would be too fatty and too strong flavored for this soup. You want something mild. And I used to go out of my way to get as many different fish varieties as I could find in the Boston area. You know, fish that come whole. Red snapper, dorade, branzino, on occasion, even rascas rouge. So, why am I down to just branzino? Because the other fish cost about the same, but they don't have either the flavor or the texture of branzino in this preparation. This doesn't mean that you should use branzino. You should use whatever fish you think you will enjoy the most, as long as it's mild. Here are my fish frames. For Halloween, we can call them skeletons. Let's check if my fishmonger did a good job cleaning them. They did okay, but not great. If there is still a membrane covering the spine, cut it open. We want the spine exposed. We want to get rid of as many organs and bloody parts as possible, since they can make your stock bitter. If you see any yellow-green spots on the flesh, this means that the fishmonger by accident punctured the gallbladder while gutting the fish. Occasionally, it happens even with good fishmongers. The yellow-green liquid that comes out of the gallbladder can make your stock bitter. So I suggest that you take your kitchen shears and cut off any part of the frame that looks like this. We'll have better access if we snip the collar of the fish to expose the insides. See all this gunk? We need to get rid of it. Grab a paper towel and rip out whatever insides you can get your hands on. Are you still watching? I probably just freaked out half of my audience. But don't worry, the rest of the video won't be nearly as scary. Unless you have a very meticulous fishmonger, your fish fillets probably still have pin bones in them. They run from the head to the middle of the fillet right here. Since eating a bony soup is no one's idea of fun, I suggest you cut them out like this and add to your stock. I also asked my fishmonger to save me the skins, since they add so much gelatin to the stock. This is a great opportunity to salt your fillets and put them in the fridge until we need them. Put your fish frames and the skins in the pot. Now it's time for aromatics. Basically, it's the tough parts of the veggies that we're going to put into our soup. Leeks and fennel. And a few other things if you have them. I rinsed the outside of my leek, but it is still very dirty inside, especially the tops. Let's cut off the green parts to use in the stock. Discard 2 to 3 outer layers, separate the rest, and rinse very thoroughly. Discard any dried up parts. Chop the rest coarsely to use for stock. The light green core is tender enough to save for soup. Cut off the fennel tops to add to stock. One celery rib, and we have our veggies. Add a bunch of thyme, bay leaf, and some whole black peppercorns, about a teaspoon. Add 7 cups of water, or just enough to cover the fish and veggies. Set over high heat and bring to a boil. Stir once. This gets the fish away from the walls so that it doesn't stick too bad by the end of cooking. This just makes it easier to wash the pot later. It doesn't affect the taste at all. Reduce heat so that the stock is simmering very, very gently, and cook uncovered for 45 minutes. No need to skim unless you have nothing better to do with your life. I know it seems counterintuitive. I used to skim stocks my whole life, but look, there's really no point if you'll be straining them. Let's talk about saffron. Since it's such an expensive and a somewhat misunderstood ingredient, it takes at least 20 minutes for the saffron color and aroma to come out after you add some liquid to it. So if you taste your dish right after adding saffron, you'll probably think that you need more. But all you had to do was wait a little bit. Our whole dish will only need 2 tiny pinches of saffron. If you crumble up those pinches, each one would probably be a 1/16 of a teaspoon, maybe even less. One of those pinches will go into the soup, and the other pinch will go into the rouille, which is a garlicky saffron mayo that we're going to slather on toasts and put on top of our soup. I suggest you make your rouille several hours before serving the soup so that the saffron has a chance to infuse the mayo. Put a tiny pinch of saffron into a small bowl. Squeeze about a teaspoon of lemon juice into it. Add a garlic clove grated on a microplane zester. Add 1/2 cup of mayo, a pinch of cayenne, and mix it all up. At first, nothing will happen, but by the time we are done with the soup, you'll see lots of orange spots in your rouille, and once you mix it all up, you'll have a beautifully golden sauce. Don't forget to taste for salt. Cover and put in the fridge until you're ready to serve your soup. Now our stock is cooking, our rouille is infusing, and it's time to make the soup. Cut the fennel in half. See this triangular core? It's too tough to add to the soup. We'll cut around it and throw it in the stock. Use the tip of your knife to slice the fennel, but keep it attached at the root. Then cut it crosswise until you get to the tough core. Then cut on one side of the core, on the other side, and behind it. Add the core to the stock and save the chopped up fennel for soup. Cut the sides of the pepper off. This is the easiest way I know to get rid of seeds. Then cut off the bottom. Slice the pepper lengthwise and then crosswise. Cut the white and pale green parts of the leek into manageable pieces. Then cut in half lengthwise. Check for sand. If you see any, flip through the layers under running water until you rinse out all the sand. Slice the leeks lengthwise and then crosswise. Also dice the pale green core from the top of the leek. This is usable for the soup. No need to add it to stock. Put the fennel, peppers, and leeks into a large pot. Add 1/4 cup of olive oil, a generous pinch of salt, and set it over medium heat. Salt is not saffron, so when I say a pinch, I mean 5-fingered pinch. Stir everything together and leave it all alone until the bottom browns. This can take 3 to 4 minutes. Don't stir until you take a peek on the side and see browning. Keep cooking your veggies, stirring only when they brown, until they have lots of brown spots. You want golden brown, not mahogany brown. This will take about 15 minutes. If the bottom of the pot seems dry, add a bit more oil and turn down the heat at the slightest sign of burning. Add 2 to 3 cloves of minced garlic and cook for a few minutes until garlic is aromatic. Add a tiny pinch of saffron. I'll wash out my dish with water and add it to the pot not to waste any of this precious spice. Add 2 star anise and a 14.5-ounce can of diced tomatoes. Add 2/3 of a cup of dry white wine and boil it all for about 5 minutes to evaporate the alcohol from the wine. Let's strain the fish stock through a fine mesh strainer into the pot with veggies. Oh look, it's a fish eyeball. I find my comfort with fish body parts really empowering because I have a dark little secret. You see, I have not seen a lobster until I was about 18 years old. And they still freak me out. I mean, they look like giant cockroaches. Of course, I realize that my fear of lobsters is completely irrational. Once you put that cockroach into a lobster roll or a lobster bisque, it becomes the best thing ever. But how embarrassing! I am a New England cook who is afraid of lobsters. But I make up for it with my complete fearlessness when it comes to fish.
Have you seen my eyeballs?
Now we need to season our soup with salt. This is a crucial moment. You've got to get this right or you'll have a pathetic soup. There is no way I can give you measurements since your salt might be different from mine. Your canned tomatoes might have salt in them and mine didn't, etc. If you suffer from salt phobia, separate a little into a bowl and practice on that. Add 2 tablespoons of heavy cream, bring to a boil, cook gently for 5 minutes and turn off the heat. Up to this point, the soup could be made ahead. You could even make it a day ahead and rewarm. 20 minutes before you're ready to serve, preheat the oven to 350 Fahrenheit and brush some good crusty bread with olive oil on both sides. Toast in the oven until crispy and brown, about 10 to 15 minutes. Wait for the soup to cool off to about 180 Fahrenheit. If you don't have a thermometer, wait 15 minutes after you take the soup off the heat. I love the olive oil floating on top of the soup, but if it's too much for your taste, this is a good opportunity to skim some off. Add the fish fillets to the soup and separate them with a spoon so that each one has good contact with the hot soup. Do not turn the burner back on. After 8 to 10 minutes, your fish should break in the thickest part when firmly prodded with a spoon. Cooking fish at this lower temperature is a bit slower, but results in amazing texture. Before serving, break up the fish just a bit. And of course, if you're substituting a thicker fish than branzino, it would take longer. When the toasts come out of the oven, rub them all over with a garlic clove. A bit of salt helps to get those garlic juices going. Slather the rouille on top of toasts, pour the soup into bowls, and top with the toast. As the toast absorbs the soup, it becomes one of the most delicious things in this world. If I had to eat one soup for the rest of my life, this would be it. The aroma is simply intoxicating. If you have any questions or if you make this soup and have feedback for me, don't forget to start your comment with hashtag #realcomment. Thank you so much for putting up with my fish humor. Here are some more in-depth cooking tutorials for you to check out. And if you're ever in the Boston area, maybe I'll see you in one of my classes.